On a nice sunny day, Marcus has dragged me out to the garage where I can see something called a marker slice, something I'm not very good at using. Is this going to be a demonstration to put me into shame?
It is, Gaz. So we're going to be looking at making off a SWA gland. And we know you've got a video that you've posted in the past of using a hacksaw. We're now going to bring you slightly into the future of using this tool here.
Marcus. So first of all, we need to work out what size this armoured is.
Yeah, so we can do that by looking at indications on the side. Generally on site, you're going to know what size cable it is you're using. We've got a 4-core 6mm SWA here.
Right.
So what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to look on the gland pack to ensure we've got the right size gland. So if we look on here, we've got 4-core here, go along to 6mm.
Yep.
It shows us that we need a 20, not a 20S, a 20.
So it's got the standard size gland body, but goes inside a 20mm hole.
It does, yes.
Okay, so it's like an old gland pack as well. We've dug out of the garage.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, well, this is the bit I'm excited to see, is this slice, the marked slice in action. So while you get the pack open, we'll just take a little bit of a look at it. It's got a hacksaw blade in there, hasn't it?
It has, yes.
So it is using the traditional hacksaw.
It is, yeah, but just in a slightly different way, so...
Here we go then. So you're going to just remind us what we've got here?
Yep. So we've got a shroud.
Yep.
There.
We've got a couple of...
gland bodies.
Gland bodies, yes. Yeah. And
then we've got our gland nuts.
Okay, gland nuts as well. Yep. And what are those other things there? What are they?
They are earthing rings.
Okay, often called on site.
Banjos.
Yeah, and a couple of 20mm lock nuts as well.
Yes.
So just make it off at a reasonable length for me. It's obviously a scrap piece cable a lot we'd have at college. So you're going to put the shroud on first?
Put the shroud on first, find my mark.
Okay.
So you can see that there. So I know where to cut it off because I don't want this to be too loose.
Okay.
So I don't want it to be falling down the cable as such.
Okay. So we've got a little mark on there.
Yeah.
And we don't want it to go slide off the other end, do we?
No, we don't. No.
And what happens at college is often we forget to put this on, which is okay with the cable being really short in length.
Yeah.
Because we slide it on the other end. But if we make both ends off, obviously we've got no shroud.
Yeah. So
that should be pretty tight
on. Yeah, it should be. So if you're holding it up, it doesn't slide down on itself.
Give it a waggle, see if it moves. It doesn't, so that's good. Yeah. Okay.
So we're going to push that down to one side. Naturally, on site, you're not going to have the benefit always of having both ends.
No, you're not.
Yeah, so if we did forget this at this stage, it wouldn't be the end of the world.
Okay.
I'm then going to slide on my gland nut as well.
Okay, yep.
So, so that's ready there to terminate.
Okay, yep. And here we go. Are we in with it now?
We are going to be in with it. So,
are there any bits to note on the marker slice?
Yeah, so it shows you there's a certain rotation, okay, that we must rotate, and that's here and here.
Okay, so just hold it still to see that. So which way you need to rotate it when you're going round? So
when you're going marks.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Which is it counterintuitive? Is it in reverse or what you think would be reverse?
I suppose so, yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to slide that onto there.
Yeah, and then all I'm going to do, so I'm just going to turn this dowel here, okay, and turn it.
Now, this is a bit what I always get wrong. I always tighten it too much and then can't twist it.
Yeah, sometimes if you over-tighten it, it just catches straight with the armouring. And what happens is it feels like you're twisting the armouring and you're sort of snagging it away. So what I like to do, and I know there's different ways of doing it with this particular tool, is I'll like to just go in a little bit first of all.
Yeah.
Like so.
You can just hear it. Well, you're going the wrong way, were you?
Yeah, I was.
Follow the arrows.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've made a little bit of mark.
Yeah.
So as we come around there.
And then I like to tighten it as I'm going around. So.
Ah, so you do a little, so if I pull back, a little twist.
Yeah.
Go again. And now I can hear it cutting into the armouring.
You can hear it hitting the armouring. And if you tighten it too much, it sort of brings the cable round. So you know you've maybe gone a little bit too much.
And that's where I called it the toffee twister, wasn't it? Because I was too tight with it. So it's a little bit, rather than Gary trying to go through it like berserk. Yeah. Okay, so that's good. Locking your new top as well. I haven't seen these before. The old Spark Safe Electrical. Yeah. I didn't get one, but it's nice. Okay, so.
You didn't get one yet.
Yeah, all right. I like that. That's a better thing. So we're going around. Can I just have a little close look at what's happening with that blade?
Yep. So you can see it in there.
Yeah, I can. I can see it. Yeah, so you can see bits of
metal. Swarf almost,
spraying out there as well. So we know we're cutting into it. I suppose the beauty of this is you're cutting all sides of it at the right depth at the same time, whereas with a hacksaw you can tend to do the top really well
and then the bottom you don't, and especially you know with your hacksaw, when you've got your hacksaw, how sharp it is and how much you need to go in, whereas with somebody else's, if you've nicked your apprentices or something like that, sometimes you can have that problem.
Okay.
So I'm going to say that's probably enough now.
Okay, so that's through pretty much through feel and judgment. Yep. You think you've got there enough. That some people say there is a way of telling how far to go, and we couldn't find any instructions to suggest what we need to do. So we're going in with that.
So we can slide it off. So then I can just have a look to see. You can see there how I've got a nice score all the way around.
So it's all the way around. Whereas normally with a hacksaw, we're looking for the bits we've missed.
Yeah.
whereas you don't think we've missed any bits there?
No.
Okay, so brand new knife now. So away from your thumb towards your chum.
Yeah, no Stanley.
Okay,
straight off. And then what I can do is I can start unraveling the SWA, wiggle back and forward.
Oh, wow.
Off nicely.
I did. So what we end up getting is like a horseshoe effect, don't we? Like a curled over end where we haven't hacksawed
it enough, yeah.
And you end up work hardening it, don't you?
Yes.
You end up just...
And then when you're trying to get the glam body on, it can be a bit of a pain.
It can be a real pain, yeah. That's an apprentice mistake, isn't it? I don't dig in enough. So... Yeah. So would it be a tool that you'd recommend for people training, or would you recommend?
Yeah, definitely. Well, I still think it's important to be able to use hand tools such as hacksaws. You know, they're not the cheapest in the world. So, not everyone's going to have one of these, or you might find that you've left it at home, etc.
Yeah, it's not too bad, is it? Not too bad. Okay. Problem is with being really short is obviously we can get the move up and down, can't we? The armouring's actually another trick for college is, as you move it around, actually the armouring's changing length.
Yeah.
Because you've got such a short piece of cable.
Then we're going to score round. And we're just going to bring...
Okay, so we've got that one off.
The PVC sheath off to expose our armouring. This is the part that's going to go into the glam body itself.
Yeah, so we've got that.
Yeah.
Okay, I like that. So, it's just the gland body. Now, you've got to get it on the right way around, and it's pretty obvious for us electricians, but it's what I call like the, is it knurling they call that?
Yes, thimble. I believe so. Yeah, like a thimble, isn't it? Sometimes you have an olive present as well.
Yep.
You've got to make sure that's the right way around. Some glands actually have like a chamfered olive, depending on which size cable you've got. You put it a different way. So it's always important. And they often, when you take out the pack, they fall out and you put it in the wrong way. You go to do it and the armouring's sliding out. So all I'm going to do is I'm just going to get a rotating motion like this.
Yeah.
To try and make a bit of a gap
okay.
in the armouring itself.
And then you're going to
And then I'm just going to slide that over, just making sure I haven't missed it at all. I'm going to slightly bring it back a little bit as well, because the force of me pushing both the gland body and gland nut together is going to slide the armouring up. If you push it too much and you get onto a thread, what happens is you tend to try and cross thread it, or you can't get it on.
Okay. So pull it back slightly. We've got no crossing over.
Yeah,
and so slightly out of fully in.
Yeah.
And then once we meet the threads together, is that where you put the pressure back on the glam body? Yeah.
Yeah, it is. So, you push it down. I always tend to tighten this side here.
Yeah.
Yeah, because if you start to tighten this side, what happens is you start to twist the armour in itself, and then you sort of feel it not correct. And I always go up as hand tight as I can first.
Yeah.
Because what I like to do then, just give it a bit of a pull, just to make sure it's actually bitten onto the armouring at this point.
Okay.
I'm not using my full force.
Yeah.
Just in case it's not bit on, it's going to come sliding off.
Okay. Good advice again. Yeah. So that's that. And now at college, often we use spanners. Obviously, in the real world, we tend to use our adjustable grips. The reason why we can get away with adjustable grips in the real world is that you're only really going to tighten this on once, whereas they can take a bit of the brass off the body, can't they?
Yeah, they can. Adjustable
grips.
But like you said, in a college setting, them glands are reused, and the more people use these and damage them, the more you have to go out and purchase them.
Yeah, absolutely. So is he going to get them around the right way? He's going to hold that one that way.
That one there.
Are you going to do it that way? Well, I probably would have had one pair of the other way around, but comment below what you'd have done with your grips. Okay, so.
And then we're just going to tighten it like so, holding that side on and tightening the gland nut itself.
Yeah. Until we've got that super tight, because it is going to be the connection for our protective conductor, isn't it? Because we've only got a four-core armoured,
exactly,
we're feeding a three-phase and neutral. We've got our protective conductor here by the armouring, which is made of steel, higher resistivity, so it's not as good a conductor as copper.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But so I'm just going to check now that I haven't gone underneath the glam body and everything has no crossovers, etc.
But if you think about the amount of material, that is the amount of steel that is your protective conductor. That's a hefty amount of material, even though it's not as good a conductor as copper. There's a lot of it there compared to 6 mil copper, isn't
there? There is, yes.
Okay, so let's have a little look at that. So you're going to rotate around for us. And that's pretty good to me. So when we bring the shroud up now, we don't expect to see those armours.
No, we don't. If we had an external gland here, that's where we would then tighten the external part onto it, making sure it's very important that there's none of the armouring on show, because then that gets rid of the need of the external gland.
Do you want to take the bedding material off now for me?
Yeah.
So how close do you go to the actual gland body?
I don't go right up to it.
No.
Because I want to sort of preserve the life of it. If there's any issues in the future, I don't want that to end up shorting onto this, because this is going to be connected to the great mass of Earthfire, a fly lead or an earthing ring, etc.
Yeah, so what we want there is our live conductors rub against the body over time. So we'll leave a bit of bedding material up there, about thumb's width.
Yeah.
And then we rotate that and that comes off. Now this can be anything at college, can it? It can be really easy. It peels off like the skin of a banana.
Yeah. And sometimes
it's a nightmare, isn't it, to get that bedding material off. Yeah. Sometimes I do it like flex, just break it away. Yeah,
Score around, break away first.
And then
just to make sure we don't go into any of them cores.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And then when you twist it off, you've got to sort of twist it with the cable, haven't you?
Yes.
To get it off.
And sometimes you just need a final score.
Yeah, rocking with that nice.
Tensioned.
There we go. So last little bit of that bedding material is always something that's going to be awkward, isn't it? So,
yeah.
So you're going to twist at the side. I like it. You're doing that twist, aren't you? So you're twisting with
twisting the way the cables are twisting as well. And then that will bring them.
And there are conductors. And we've got our three lines, brown, black, grey, and our blue neutral conductor, because the armour in itself is providing our protective conductor.
Yes, which is quite common in an industrial setting, isn't it?
And if you want to see the parts of a CW Gland kit, we used a BW one, check out the video on screen now.